welcome to South Garda for the first round of the European Karting Championships. Super A and the A's will show you both of the sets of finals from the action of the opening round of the championships 2 weeks ago. But first, a few pictures just to set the scene at this Italian circuit. Well, the European Championships kicked off at South Garda in Italy, as you can see, in fine weather. The drivers, the newcomers and the old hands alike, introducing themselves to the crowd.
This is the first event of the 1996 World Championship, but it is also the test race for the World Championship, because the World Championship will take place here on this circuit, on this beautiful circuit, which is already prepared for that big event.
You have a lot of competitors, many newcomers?
Yes, we have 175 competitors. We have allowed about six from Japan. We have a driver from Indonesia, which means that this championship has now a very, very big success.
Even in the European Championship, you cover the whole world?
Yes, we cover the whole world, because the European Championship is an open championship and leads for qualification to the World Championship.
Any instructions for the young new drivers?
To stay calm and to watch the others.
Hans Buter there, the CIK president, the president of the International Karting Federation. And good advice to the newcomers, particularly those fresh to the European scene. Pick up the tips from the more experienced drivers, and there are plenty of those around as well. There's Buter and the rest of the FIA and CIK officials. And this is the pace car for the series. It's one of the legend race cars, initially brought over from America, where they have a racing series, also racing in the UK. 110 brake horsepower Yamaha 1200cc bike engine and six-speed gearbox. Makes them quick enough to stay ahead of the pack, at least. Now they line up for the first of the Formula A races. Around goes the pace car, and the kart's trying to work a bit of heat into the tyres despite the spring sunshine. Temperatures still relatively low. But the Italian lake's a fabulous location. And on pole position, Giovanni Maera. The Italian having won straight heats, all of his heats, straight victories. Just missing the cut here after finishing eighth in the repechage race. Newcomer from the UK, Stuart Costera. But there with the Union Jack on his helmet, right up at the front of the grid, is Jenson Button. Qualified fifth on number 102, but leading them down as they go into the first corner is Giorgio Pantano on 167. And a first lap shunt. So already the drivers finding themselves in trouble. That's Mikael Molin from Sweden and Denis Lemoine from France. And all triggered by James Courtney of Australia running over the back of Lemoine's kart. Now take a look at the kart 167 there of Giorgio Pantano. You're going to get plenty of opportunity to see it. And what little bodywork it has, you may think, bears an uncanny resemblance to one of the Mercedes DTM cars. He's got AMG on his overalls. In fact, he's already been contracted by Mercedes, even at this lowly stage of his motor racing career. They think he is a big talent for the future, and hence he's got the same livery on his car as Bernd Schneider and Dario Franchitti have got on their German Touring Car Championship cars. Not using the Mercedes Touring Car engine, clearly. But still, to good effect, holding off the pole position man, Giovanni Maiera. And Italians making up by a long way the bulk of this field. Jenson Button there in fifth position still. Not able to improve so far on his grid slot. So Pantano leads. Mayer a second. Little puff of smoke there, these drivers. Absolutely scraping the most of the traction out of their tyres. And tyres are something that are slightly different for this season. Still round and black. Still the three companies, Vega, Bridgestone and Dunlop. But they've got together and had a gentleman's agreement to supply tyres on a very much more even footing than has been the case so far in the European Championships in previous years. There will be no favoured teams who get better compounds than any others. If you're running Bridgestones, every Bridgestone should be the same all the way up and down the field, no matter how big or small your pocket is, and the same with Vega and Dunlop. So the tyre wars, although they are still as intensely fought as ever, fought with the gloves on this time. And the competition among the drivers therefore hopefully getting ever closer. Pantano doing his very best to remove competition for first place at least. He's made a substantial breakaway, as you can see here in the early laps, and leaving the rest of them to squabble over second, and of course they do so, and that helps him a great deal in his efforts to pull away. Matteo Boscolo on 1-1-2, right in the middle of that battle. Qualified third and doing extremely well. And out of the race is Italy's Ronnie Quintarelli on 1.75. And those of you who haven't seen a great deal or indeed any karting before may wonder why the drivers take their hand off the wheel occasionally, their right hand, and reach back behind them. There you go, another example of that. They're not changing gear, they're not doing anything mechanical to the engine. What they are doing is choking the carburetor. Now, it may seem a little strange that at high speed they want to have the equivalent of the choke pulled out, but what that does is marginally reduce the airflow to richen up the mixture. These engines, the two-stroke engines that they use in karts, are very, very marginal indeed on whether or not they'll stay together. And seized engines in karting are the most common replacement item. Not brake pads, not tyres, but engines. And so choking the carburetor just gives a fraction more power without the engine tightening up at the end of the long straight when it's running wide open and very lean down the straight. So you'll quite often see them just dab the hand down, and not in that particular instance. 1-2-7 there, out he goes. That's Roberto Falento, another Italian. And as I said, there are dozens of them. And a spin there for Australia's Benjamin Horstman. Classic mistake. You see it so often in single-seater racing as well, getting one tyre onto the kerb and it just drags the machine away from you. But no such problems for the leader, Giorgio Pantano, pulling away. And now with plenty of time to look over his shoulder, and look at that gap, a vast, vast gap back down to second position. And going the long way around the outside, Boscolo takes second position. Very, very impressive driving indeed. Sandro Mara on 1.53, the third place man now, had absolutely no answer that at all. Giovanni Maiera is dropping away. 1.99, the pole position man, dropping right down the order. But pushing up hard on the Tony kart. 1.42 is Dane Nicholas Chiesa. No relation to Formula 3000 driver Andrea Chiesa, who is Italian. Spelt differently but pronounced moderately the same, at least by me. And Chiesa pushing hard, battling, swapping the lead corner by corner with Sandro Mara there. And what a gap the leader has built up. Three abreast now, very nearly, as they come down the straight there. One of the back markers, they're passing. That battle for second. And battles all the way down the field, and again, one wheel onto the curbs, and off goes Laurent Delahaye. These curbs, insignificant to a Formula racer, but when the ground clearance, as it is on these carts, is measured in fractions of an inch, then when you get up onto a 3 or 4 inch curb, that takes away every piece of rubber you've got from the ground and puts it on the grass, and there's not a great deal of traction out there. So Delahaye is out and stamping his authority very firmly indeed here. Giorgio Pantano takes the checkered flag at the end of race one. Behind him, Matteo Boscolo and Sandro Mara, second and third. Case of finishing fifth. Anthony Davidson from Great Britain, eighth. And Jenson Button dropping out of it at the end. We'll be back in a moment for more action from Garda. So welcome back to Lake Garda. This is the second of the finals for the Formula A carts. And there on 167, the winner of the first round. They start race two as they finish race one. So Giorgio Pantano on 167 leads Matteo Boscolo. Sandro Mara on 153 behind him there with the all-white helmet, unusually. And Thomas Pichler, he was fourth. And away they go on the pace lap. My goodness, somebody's off already. And a very nasty incident indeed. Sandro Mara got a big belt on the head there from a tyre, as three or four of the drivers got tangled up weaving the tyres. And look at Pantano weave some heat into those tyres. Drivers get five tyres for the two races, so that means that they have one spare essentially. It can be a front or a rear, whatever they like, but they're not allowed to replace two fronts, or a front and a rear, or two rears. So only one new tyre for the second race. They have three engines for the meeting, and so they could replace an engine if they needed to. And the race is not run consecutively. There's trouble for one of the British drivers, one of the Fullerton kart men, and out of the race already. That's a shame for him. So Anthony Davidson, who finished eighth in the first leg, looked like he had broken a steering arm. So obviously in a collision there with somebody on the warm-up lap as well, I would have thought. It seemed to be around his part of the track where all that happened on the warm-up lap. So Anthony Davidson out of it. Jenson Button still here though, out of it again. Goes 175, Ronnie Quintarelli, the Italian, not having a great deal of luck in these finals. If he could stop spinning, it might be a little bit better for him. So let's pick up and see how the leaders have sorted themselves out on this opening lap and a half. Well, there is the leader. He's sorted himself out into first position. The white helmet of Sandro Mara. Can't actually see a tyre mark on it, but the belt he got, I would imagine there is one there. Right up by that black visor. Knocked the visor over, nearly knocked his head off. 142, Nicholas Chiesa in third. That's the first of the Tony carts at the moment. And behind him, 112, Matteo Boscolo, who started second. So Boscolo didn't exactly have a quick getaway. And Pantano now under pressure, really for the first time since the opening lap of race one. Let's see how he performs here. Broadside into the corner, shutting the door and making the track narrower for the opposition. But that lost him momentum. And as we see here on the replay from the reverse angle, sweeping through into the lead, Sandro Mara. Mara runs wide now, but he has the inside line. Can he hold it? Indeed he can. Look at that, Pantano looking to turn in all the way, but he can feel the cart alongside him and just can't quite manage it. Chiesa there in third, watching this all. Pantano now muscling down on the straight. Ideal build for a kart racer, this man, for any sort of single-seater Formula racer indeed. Very small indeed. The size of him compared even to the kart behind. He really is absolutely teeny. And superbly talented as well. Let's get him out on the basketball court, see how he fares there. But in these machines, he is absolutely the right size. Barely needs to tuck down to reduce his frontal area. But he needed to tuck down a fraction more there, because this is a real seesaw battle now. And he's down to third in two corners. Very well taken opportunity indeed by Chiesa. The Tony Kart man is getting his head under the steering, and very, very well controlled slide. Superb piece of outbraking there by Pantano. And Sandro Mara, I beg his pardon, Matteo Boscolo slips past into second there, past Chiesa. Sandro is still leading, Sandro Mara, 1:53, and not now. So this really is by far and away a much more interesting race than race one. The lead being swapped between these three drivers. So far, Matteo Boscolo has not led on 1:12, but he's the only one that hasn't. Now he's making a move. Three abreast into the corner. Surely that can't work out. Amazingly, they all kept their heads and stayed on the road. Down to third again goes Pantano. And this group could be covered by the proverbial pocket handkerchief, and if this continues on the way to the flag, it's going to be anybody's guess who'll come out of the final corner in the lead. Indeed, who'll come out of the final corner at all. Now, goaded on undoubtedly by not having led so far, Boscolo on 1:12 is looking at having a go, but he left the door open, and Pantano zooms past into second. Really squats down behind that steering wheel, getting all his weight forward on the straight, which is good for turn-in as well as aerodynamic efficiency. Boscolo now down to fourth position as Chiesa comes past him again. So, Sandro Mara still leads. Giorgio Pantano behind him. And how have the other two sorted themselves out? Still Nicolas Chiesa leading Matteo Boscolo. Compare and contrast the styles then of the first two drivers. Leader now again, Giorgio Pantano. And the second place man, Sandro Mara. Pantano seems to be favouring a much more twitchy setup. Seems to be working the car a lot harder, much more input at the steering, much more movement of the hands. And Sandro Mara, perhaps because of his greater height and greater weight, with a slightly more stable kart, seems to be a much more smooth, relaxed style. But undoubtedly, both of them very effective indeed. Pantano, very nervous, very twitchy. Very much in the pointy front end that is so favoured in Formula One by drivers like Michael Schumacher and Eddie Irvine. And behind him, Sandro Mara, much more the smooth, braking early, turning in on the power early style favoured by the likes of Alain Prost himself, a very, very renowned karter. And drivers like David Coulthard taking that style very much for their own as well. Coulthard, of course, a long-time British and European kart racer before he turned to single-seaters. Now a breakaway for the first time in this race by Giorgio Pantano. And Sandro Mara being demoted now to fourth. The Martin Brundle-esque helmet of Matteo Boscolo, take it as you will. He's in third on 1:12. There he is. And to San Romano, showing absolutely no ill effects whatsoever of that cart on the head incident earlier. Some swappery of places in the midfield here. We're back with the leader. And again, look how he works the steering there. Gets the front end planted as much as he can. And then works with the back. 189 coming into the fray now. And disappearing from it as soon as we get to mention him. So we won't. So British drivers at the moment, Jenson Button working his way up into sixth position by the flag as Pantano takes it from Chiesa and Boscolo. And Nicky Routledge finishing 15th. We saw Anthony Davidson on the Fullerton Rotax there, pulling off on lap one, I'm pretty certain, as a result of that opening incident. So the English junior champion not very lucky there in the second of the Formula A races. And there is the winner, Giorgio Pantano, complete with full AMG Mercedes style overalls and the odd kart badge. We'll be back with more action, this time from the Super A's, after the break. Welcome back to South Garda in Italy for the first round of the European Car Championships. It's the first of the Super A races. The drivers getting a push start from their mechanics. And as the field heads round towards the start of the warm-up lap, problems for Dutchman Pierre Redeker. There he is on 40, the kart refusing to push start. No onboard starters here. And the mechanic in all sorts of trouble. The Tony Kart will eventually get the shove and get onto the back of the grid, but he's really blown his chances of a good start. Now let's look at the lineup of this first race. On the front of the grid, Alessandro Manetti, number 27, who raced in last year's championship very successfully, and a host of Tony Karts, Johnny Mislevich and Johan Agrell right behind him, alongside and behind three and four. Charlotte Helberg, 24, the Dutch lady who has been racing in the European Car Championship since 1989, very experienced, but always seems to be just out of luck when it comes down to the final few laps to getting onto the podium. But away they go, and ahead of the red, white and green of the Tony Karts, the blue and white picks out Italy's Alessandro Manetti. Now Manetti, last year's champion, is back this year because he's young enough to still continue in Super A karting and he enjoys it, but he's combining that with a full season of Italian Formula 3, and he's already made himself into a points finisher in the opening rounds of the Italian Formula 3 championship. So this young man undoubtedly is going to go the distance. There he is, number 27, and leading Johnny Mislevich. Behind them, qualified further down the field, Great Britain's David O'Neill, and he's on another Tony Kart, and Edward Peed as well, one of the Fullerton team. Bobby Game here as well, another of the Tony Kart drivers, and the Tony chassis battling with the CRGs here. This is the real European Car Championship chassis battle. Little grassy excursion, but no damage done in the end for 51. That's Koji Tsuda, one of the Japanese competitors. And the lead battle opening up a marginal gap, maybe a two machine gap. There's probably just about room for one other driver between them and third place. Although as they close up under braking, it doesn't look that way. Frenchman beg his pardon, a French-sounding Italian, David Foray. There he is on number two. It's in fourth at the moment. So the Tony Kart trio being chased by Charlotte Hellberg in fifth and being led by Alessandro Manetti on 27, who is out front at the moment. So CRG's bracketing this three-kart Tony train. Second, third and fourth. Now looking for the lead and taking it is Johnny Mislevich. Johan Agrell moving up. Does he hold on to his position? No, Manetti comes back at him. And now, oh dear, that was nearly both Tony Karts out of it there as David Foray thought finally at the very last moment better about going down into that long fast right-hand complex there inside his teammate. He's obviously anxious to get past and get into the battle for the lead, although the Tony Kart team would like their karts to finish 1, 2 and 3. All the drivers have their own private agendas, of course, and the fact that Johan Agrell is leading isn't going to impress any of the other men any more than it's impressing Alessandro Manetti on the CRG. 30 there is Taco Matsuya. You'll have guessed he's a Japanese too, qualified sixth. And currently running just ahead of Julien Degout on 72, one of the French riders. Heads tucked down as they chase the leader. And there he is, Johnny Mislevich. So Mislevich leads Manetti. Still Agrell there in third. And still, if we get a glimpse of him, although dropping back fractionally, David Foray in fourth. Behind him, Charlotte Hellberg in fifth. There she is. And Taco Matsuya in sixth. So that's the leading order. There's Charlotte Hellberg. And she is pushing David Foray very hard indeed. He's clearly holding them up. There's a big string behind him. Something like a dozen carts. Bumper to bumper right behind Foray, and he is not helping them in their progress up the field. Tucking his head right down. Johan Agrell there on four as they went down the straight, really getting his head between his knees on the straight. Manetti still looking for a way past. This is not the form we saw from Manetti at the end of last year. Hesitate to suggest that racing a single-seater has dented his kart form in any way, shape or form, but perhaps it has just reduced his time on the machines, his practice time. After all, Formula 3 takes a lot more getting used to for him than getting back onto a Super 8. Perhaps, though, he's fractionally underestimated the job at hand. Not to take anything away from Johnny Mislevich, he's driving a very, very confident race. Withstanding the pressure, no mistakes. And just getting on with doing what he needs to do. Hand up from 74 and cruising off into retirement. Andrea Bellici. And I think that's probably a chain. The kart looks to be in one piece. Yes, he's going over to the right rear corner. Certainly wasn't a flat, so that will be a drive problem of some kind. Charlotte Hellberg looking all over the place for a way up into third. She really is putting together a very strong run indeed now. Disposed of David Foray and looking to do very much the same with Johan Agraut. And Mislevich comes under pressure and loses the lead to Manetti. Now, Manetti had been closing up for the previous three or four corners and finally forced that marginal error that he needed just to edge his way inside. Mislevich had been meticulous with his line, absolutely giving no possible opportunity to overtake. Now, back ahead again. Let's see if he can hold on to it this time. No. Now Manetti has really got the bit between his teeth and has obviously sussed a way in which he can get past. And these two absolutely glued together. Very, very close indeed. Superb stuff. No quarter given nor asked here. And they are millimetres away from contact all the way around this circuit. You couldn't possibly wish for a closer battle for the lead. Manetti has it. Mislevich looks over his shoulder too, because he can see Agraut just shadowing around in the corners. And what he doesn't want is to be caught out, making a move on Manetti and be dissuaded from second position by Agraut and left with only third or perhaps fourth, because if he leaves the door open for Agraut, then you can be certain that Charlotte Hellberg will go straight through it as well. Now Manetti rather outfoxed there, and that's exactly as I was mentioning earlier, leave the door open and there's no telling how many people will go through it. Good move there into that fast right-hander by Manetti to take second back. Agraut, now he's got to get his head down and get back on terms with the leader. Being pushed very hard indeed by third place man though, Charlotte Hellberg right on his tail too. This is a great battle. Now as they come through this tight, tricky section, Manetti right with him again. Starts to open now and they pick up speed through the long sweep. Very bumpy last year, been resurfaced this. And far more acceptable. Under braking, Manetti goes inside, contact. Oh my goodness. How indeed. That looked a very, very uncomfortable accident for Manetti, and even more so for Johnny Mislevich, because he was underneath it all. From the other angle, up over the top of Mislevich. Oh, goodness, and he's knocked forwards off the cart. And that's even ripped the steering out of its mountings, broken the steering forwards, and that takes some doing. An awful lot of force there, knocking Mislevich over, forward, over his knees. And a very nasty looking accident. Mislevich off the cart, but not of his own volition, knocked off by the impact from Manetti's cart. Well, there you go. Contact in the battle for the lead and the lead pair out of it. So now it comes down to another Tony Kart CRG battle, and who's going to take it on the dash to the line? As they flash into the picture, the Tony Kart driver gets it. That's Johan Agraut, marginally from Charlotte Hellberg, and given another 100 yards or half a lap, it could have been a very different story. And this is Johnny Mislevich being stretched away. There is Manetti with a precautionary neck brace on. Manetti passed clear to race for the second race, but to Mislevich taken to hospital for precautionary checks and later discharged completely unharmed, bruises and scratches aside. So potentially a collarbone breaking incident, but both of them walking away at the end of the day. Now between the Super A races, the second of the A finals would have gone on, and so Minetti had time to get himself back together for the second race. And we'll be back with that in just a moment.
I adore Paris. I feel good here. It's home. We deal in emotions. We help clients realize their dreams. Le Lièvre is a long-established French company. We manufacture furnishing fabrics of the highest quality. Le Lièvre and DHL work hand in hand. I'd say that DHL is virtually an integral part of Le Lièvre. Every day we send fabrics to Tokyo, Rio, New York. Clients won't wait. We send about 2,000 consignments a month with DHL. In fact, they carry our image worldwide. I never say no to my clients. Le Lièvre never says no. DHL never says no to me.
DHL, we keep your promises.
Nothing's impossible with DHL.
Lean back!
Turn.
Move, move, move!
On your imagination.
That's using the old noodle.
Toy Story.
Back at Lake Garda then for the final action from the first round of the European Kart Championships. Four championship weekends, eight races, eight finals potentially for the drivers, and the five best scores would count. So possible to have problems, as Muslevich did there. This weekend a write-off for him, which is a shame because he looked so competitive. But he's still got five out of six races to score from left. So all is not lost yet. Just to run through the British finishers there in that last race. Bobby Game in 28th place. Edward Peed 18th on the Fullerton machine. And David O'Neill just outside the top 10 in 11th. And Bobby Game at the back of the grid for this second race. He got through in the repechage race, the last chance qualifying race for these finals, and he's at the back of the grid on 59. But leading them into the first corner, or out of the first corner, is Charlotte Hellberg on 24. Now the narrowest of margins separated her from a win last time out. A degree of kerfuffling there, and well down the order goes one of the top Tony men. And that is Johnny Muslevich. So back again for this second race. And Game to restart it. Not entirely sure I'd be in such a similar frame of mind. Everybody else long gone. Charlotte Hellberg snaps across to the racing line, shuts the door across the nose of 68, Yuri Piccianti. Guess which country he's from. And in third position, it's number four, and that is Johan Agrell. And he's got a good battle going on behind him. 60 and 61, Kentaro Kitimaki from Japan, and Kimmo Limaitinen from Finland. First Finnish racer that's called Smith is going to have a very, very welcoming press corps to meet him. Down in the order, number two, David Foray. So the Tony Kart's really getting spread out here, and only Johan Agrell has got anything like a competitive showing at the moment. And he started this race from pole and has dropped to third on the opening burst. So he's not exactly showing too strongly either. 66, David O'Neill just going through there, one of the British men on the Tony Karts. And running wide onto the kerbs, just getting away with it, Natale Maggio, 26, the Italian number, as opposed to the age of the driver, considerably younger than that. And Charlotte Hellberg, one of the most experienced drivers in the field, without a doubt, and putting that experience to good measure now. 27 there, Alessandro Minetti right in the midst of it. There's Bobby Game again, just two spots behind him. And a degree of, as Bill McLaren would say, argy-bargy going on here. David Fauré out of it, and judging by the state of his kart, not entirely without incident. Look to pick up Minetti. There he is, 27. Way down, must be 12th, 14th at this stage, I would have thought. Charlotte Hellberg opening up a gap. And quite a handsome one at that. Minetti moving to pick up another space. Bobby Game doing likewise. Just trying to keep himself ahead of that battling trio. Selma Maitinen on 61. And Kitakami. Kentaro Kitakami on 60. Chasing the leader. And there she is, Charlotte Hellberg. Not many Dutch racers in this championship, and she is undoubtedly their leading talent on this showing. Second place still is 68, Yuri Piccianti, the Italian. And still the Finn leads the Japanese, third and fourth. Oh my goodness! Now that looked to be, oh dear. Frightening looking cartwheel there for Britain's Edward Peed. Very nasty looking accident indeed, over the top, over the back of the cart of Nicola Gianiberti. So Edward Peed out of it, I'm afraid. Not the most successful weekend for Terry Fullerton's team. More damage than pots going home, that's for sure. But still, the former champ and his protégés will undoubtedly be back to battle on. Inserting himself between the third and fourth place men, Cesare Balestieri on six. Now taking fourth, and pushing the Japanese Kitakami down to fifth. 40 there, we just saw Pierre Redeker, who couldn't get his machine to start for the last race, and another shot of him battling hard with another Japanese, Tako Matsuya, number 30. Again, we saw him featuring strongly in the early going of race one. Charlotte Hellberg looking very untroubled by it all, just easing away from the rest of them. And a perfect race for her, from second on the grid, pushing her way up into the lead, metaphorically, on the first lap. Not to suggest any wrongdoing of any kind. And this battle still going on between the fourth and fifth place men, as I think they are at the moment. Fifth and sixth make that. And some position swappery as well going on between Lemaitinen on 61 and Balestieri on six. Lemaitinen leading it at the moment. And Manetti's moving up now inside the top 10. I would guesstimate him to be in about eighth or ninth. Very firm overtaking manoeuvre there by 72, and that's Julien Degout. Saw him spinning out in heat one, doing rather better this time. And Charlotte Hellberg looks as if she could be just out testing tyres or something. She's so unflustered by the battles going on behind her, and she's really stringing out this leading pair, the pace getting away from that third place pair, rather. Still, Yuri Picchanti very much on his own in second place. Unable to make an impression on Charlotte Hellberg, but comfortably ahead of this third place battle. There's Charlotte Hellberg just flashing into shot in a moment or two. Should be Picchanti, but no. Moving on to an all Tony Kart battle. And Bobby Game being passed by his teammate Gastão Fraguas of Brazil. That won't impress Bobby too much. That's a demon overtaking going on there. Bobby Game on 59, pushing through into that long, fast right-hander. I apologise now unreservedly to David O'Neill, who is on 66, who I've been calling Bobby Game all the way through the race. So sorry, David. If you can find out where I live, come round and remonstrate. Other than that, apologies. That's what comes of having the same colour overalls. Can't expect me to recognise numbers differently. Goodness gracious. So the two Brits, there they are, 66 and 59. Very close together indeed in the running order. And there on 66 is David O'Neill. And David just being held out of the top 10 by Gastão Fraguas. Charlotte Hellberg romping away with this, 26 laps, and she has barely been challenged since lap one. Again, a much more stable setup she seems to be looking at on her machine than Mantano that we saw dominating the Formula A's. And again, a little bit less of a twitchy front end. Seems to be much more relaxed on the machine. But of course, she opened up a huge gap. And you know, I'm not entirely sure that she's not quite happy with herself after that. She seems to be moderately chuffed as well. She probably should be. So that's the order then. She beat Yuri Picchanti, Kimmo Laitinen, Cesare Balestieri.
Incredible. I don't understand this. It's happening so many years and so many bad luck. So many times going fast and never... it's really... for me, it's like 10 times winning this.
You told me you were a slow starter, but you, from the beginning you went off and nobody saw you anymore.
No, but always complain then that I don't warm up the tyres, I'm too slow the first lap, so I try a little bit more to warm up the tyres, and then I saw I have a little bit gap, so I think I try to push more. And I must say, my mechanic really did a super job for the final. What we decided was really, and the engines, everything was really good.
Are we going to see more of this?
I think so. My feelings is also this year, every race is going very well. Also with overtaking, and now I feel very confident, but you never know what can happen in the race.
You want to say something to your friends in Holland?
I want to say something to...
In Dutch?
No, I want to say something to my mother. Dag mama.
Well, you can see the emotion there. Charlotte Hellberg clearly very, very overcome with her victory here, and rightly so. Now, just to recap, Edward Peed, we saw cartwheeling out there, hopefully with no injury. Certainly looked to be able to move around afterwards. Bobby Game was 13th, David O'Neill 11th, so just kept out of the top 10 by yet another of the Tony Karts. But the very delighted Charlotte Hellberg now leading the Super A Championship as they go into the second round, and we'll bring you that action on Eurosport in the weeks to come. So join us for that. In the meanwhile, I'm Martin Haven saying thank you for watching and goodbye.